Well, let's take a look at this, but let's do it in the order in which the processes in photosynthesis actually happen. So the first part is dealing with the light. And when we deal with the light, we are going to look into photosystems. In order to do this in a plant, as I mentioned before, you have to assemble a certain number of pieces. The chloroplast is the critical ingredient here, and the chloroplast is able to absorb certain wavelengths of light and convert them to chemical energy. The chloroplast, in fact, has a variety of pigments in it, and they are able to pick up a variety of wavelengths of light. This most important one of these pigments is called chlorophyll. Now let me tell you a couple of things about light and how it works. In the case of our light in this room, we have light that comes from the lamps, and whatever object is illuminated, this object can be seen by us because there is a reflection, and that reflection is what goes into our eyeballs. So this is how things work in basic terms. Now, if this light that comes from the ceiling is white, the way it is now, and I see your sweater as red, that means of this white light, the red is reflected back to me. Everything else is absorbed. If your sweater is white, and I see white, then all the wavelengths from the lamps are reflected back to me. If your shirt or your sweater is black, then nothing is reflected back to me. And so rather than seeing wavelengths of light reflected at me, what I'm seeing is an absence of wavelengths. That's why people say that black isn't actually a color in terms of the reflection of light. Now, in the case of leaves, the light shines on them, and we perceive sunlight as vaguely yellow because it comes through the atmosphere. But of course, as you all know, the wavelengths that are reaching us from the sun change during the day. In the evening, for example, the sun sometimes is orange or even reddish when you have a nice sunset. And so those change based on the angle at which the sunlight enters the atmosphere. But if the sun is right overhead, it's pretty bright and pretty white. And so we have the sunlight coming in, and in the case of the plants, it hits the chlorophyll, the sunlight, and as it goes through the chloroplasts and into the chlorophyll molecules, all kinds of wavelengths are absorbed, but green comes back out at us. We call these things green plants because that is the light they reflect, and it is also the light they transmit. In this picture, you can see that the sunlight actually comes from above these leaves, and it shines through them because they're thin, and it still looks green. So whether you look at the leaf from the top side or whether you look through the leaf, it's still going to look green. And that tells you that green is not a set of wavelengths that the plant absorbs. It absorbs everything else, but not green. So we're not interested in green light. Green light does not help us photosynthesize. If you had a plant and you were to shine green light on it, it would not photosynthesize because it can't deal with green light. So how does this work? How do photosystems actually work? Well, when you look at light and you figure out what light actually is, people have realized a long time ago that light is an odd thing. Light behaves as a packet of energy. And these packets of energy we call photons. Photons, electrons. Both of those have almost no weight. Both of those travel very fast. Both of those have a lot of energy. And what these photons do is they hit these plant pigment molecules. I say here they collide violently. And I say they collide violently because that is ultimately what they do. They're not just coming in nice and easy. they're coming in like a fastball into a catcher's mitt. Bam! That makes noise. If you go to a baseball game, and of course it's playoff time, right? You go to a baseball game and you have somebody throw a fastball at the catcher, you can hear that in the stadium when that ball hits the mitt of the catcher. There's a lot of energy in that. Now, how fast is a fastball? Let's call it, what, 95, 98, right? Something like that, miles per hour. That's fast. If you stand in front of that ball and you just let it hit you, that's going to hurt. So that's why it's a violent collision. And these photons, even though they hardly have any weight, basically no measurable weight, when they hit a little molecule like that, it imparts a huge amount of energy. So much energy that the pigment molecules actually start to move around. So when the chlorophyll molecules absorb the photons, one thing that happens is that the bonds in this chlorophyll, they gain energy. They get nervous. They titter. And so this kind of electron energy, or the kind of energy that's imparted by this photon, is ultimately the cause for us being able to convert this light energy into bond energy. There's so much energy there that the surrounding water actually gets split. Now again, back to that fastball, let's think about how the catcher catches it. If you just put out your arm and let it leave it stiff, and that fastball hits you, that can cause some damage. So you don't want to do that. What you instead have to do when it's coming at you that fast, you have to move your hand, your arm, your elbow, your shoulder back, in fact, in your entire body a little bit, to absorb it. Right? That's the way you're going to be able to absorb this fastball, and it takes some skill to do it right so that you don't get hurt. Now, if somebody were to stand right behind the hand of the catcher as the catcher catches the fastball, whap, they'd probably get knocked on their butt, wouldn't they? And because of that happening, the same type of energy transfer also happens inside of this chlorophyll molecule structure. That molecule moves a little bit. It displays that little give, that little energy gain. And because it then backs into the water molecule surrounding it, that energy splits the water. And as it splits the water, that is where the oxygen comes from. This is a waste product of photosynthesis. This waste product is going to be our very important molecule for cellular respiration. It's a waste. That's how it started. So water gets split. The second thing that happens is that the energy that's imparted to the covalent bonds of the chlorophyll are able to be transferred. And as they get transferred, they're going to be transferred as chemical energy into a photosystem. The term photosystem is something that I should explain because you're not familiar with that term. You are familiar with this term. And your camera has a photosystem in it. Why? Well, if the light comes into your camera, you can open the shutter, and the light will go into your camera, and at the back end of your camera, you're going to have digital receptors. You're going to have sensors there, and these sensors are going to be tickled, if you will, by the light. They're going to be activated. These sensors are going to pick up the signature of that light. Well, that's a form of electrical energy. So the light, in this case, imparts electrical energy in the form of electrons to your digital camera, and you can then transfer that to memory. Well, in the photosystem in plants, we don't have a camera like this, but we have a variety of molecules. Now, if you went not with a digital camera, that's what this is, a digital camera, but you went with one of the older film cameras, the film is actually a chemical device. And you were able to take pictures with that. So that is how your camera transforms light energy into chemical energy. So photosystems are the key to this. Let's set up one of these photosystems inside of our chloroplast. So we already know we need the pigment. We are going to get an energy boost from these photons. And that energy boost, that's the chemical energy we can then transfer to the place where the sugar is made. Now notice how this all fits together. First of all, we're going to look carefully at one of these places where the membranes are stacked up. We're going to look at one of those little membranes. So once again, membranes as workbench space are key. In this case, we have pigment molecules that are embedded. So this is a complex of pigment. It's a relatively large inserted molecule here. It floats in this layer of phospholipids. And if you look at it from the top down, you will see that there are a variety of molecules of chlorophyll that make up this cluster. And we call these antenna pigments, because they are antennas in the sense that they're picking up the beam of light. So the photon comes in, bam! It imparts so much energy on this area that it gets passed around a little bit. This energy is moving things around. That's what I say when the catcher's mitt is moving backwards. And it's kind of hitting things. It's hitting the air molecules. And in this case, of course, it hits a variety of things. One of the things it hits is the water. So as it gets to transferred through these various antenna molecules, the water is split. And at the very end, there is so much energy left that an electron is boosted to a primary electron acceptor. Now, we talked about electron acceptors in Chapter 6. We dumped electrons and hydrogen ions to electron acceptors in a membrane. And this is, of course, the next thing we're going to have to look at. We're now starting to realize, after all this light business is done, we are dealing with electrons. And here is how that looks like in terms of an electron transport chain. So we're starting out at the bottom here. We have this water-splitting photosystem. The light comes in. It hits the reaction center chlorophyll with a lot of energy. This reaction right there, the slamming of this light particle into the chlorophyll, splits water. What does it split it into? It splits it into oxygen, hydrogen, and electrons. These electrons get boosted to an electron acceptor. The electron acceptor is going to pass the electron on to the next, to the next, to the next. That's our electron transport chain. And this electron transport chain is once again composed of a variety of molecules that undergo redox reactions. Now, you recognize some of these terms, don't you? Electron transport chain, there it is, redox reaction, electron acceptors, and of course, we can do the same thing. As the electron falls down the energy hill, we can pick up a little bit of energy to make ATP. Now, based on what you see here, you would probably say, this is what we're going to do. We're going to put this in a membrane, and we're going to let the electron jump back through that membrane. And as we do this, we're going to pump hydrogen ions through that membrane. We've done this before. That's what we did in chemiosmosis, didn't we? Okay, well, maybe this is what's coming. But in addition, we have a second photosystem. And the second one produces a little bit of another energy-rich molecule. This one, NADP. That looks familiar. Remember, we had NAD+. The only difference here is that there is now a P, a phosphate group. in there. Well, phosphate group means energy. So this actually carries with it a little bit of energy in addition to the electrons. So we're making energy here. We're making a little bit of energy there. Two places where we make energy. Again, this is a really cool and efficient system. If you're going to grow up and be a big organism, you need efficient. And this is what gives it to you. And there it is. We put it all together. This is stuff we've already seen. We have in a membrane an electron transport chain. We are pumping hydrogen ions through that membrane. The hydrogen ions accumulate, and if they accumulate, well, they want to go back to the other side. Where do they go? Oh, look at that. We even have ATP synthase. ATP synthase in plants and animals. Anything that goes through photosynthesis or respiration has ATP synthase. ATP synthase is one of the essential molecules for living organisms. If you're going to be an organism of any size, multiple cells, you're going to need this. And you have it. All multicellular organisms have ATP synthase. And they operate the same. They produce ATP for us. Now, once you have completed this process, you can send these energy-rich molecules off to the Calvin cycle. And with that energy, you can make some sugar.